between the presentation coming along for all.
Yes, Tavalji, I could based on the template, I just tried to fit in my idea and it worked out.
Tavalji, when I have made my presentation, my idea has come out nice for me.
Yes, Tavalji, when I have made my presentation.
Okay, great. So let us do this. Let us. Hello. Yes, go ahead. Yeah, so let us do this. Let us start with the presentations in an alphabetical order. And let us time box it as well so that we have enough time for the debate and question answers and follow-up questions. So let us start with, and if in case you don't have the idea or presentation when I call out your name, let me know. So let us start with Adesh.
Yes, Dhavalji. Should I share my screen?
Yes.
So everyone see my screen?
Yes, Adesh.
Okay.
Can others mute, please? Somebody is talking.
Okay, so I have taken AI for cultural heritage. So I have I have got the idea of an app which says near extinction languages. So now my help will help to bring up the languages which are near extinction. In still developing countries, if this idea is spread, then it will benefit a lot. Like if we spread this somewhere in South Africa or Maldives, their ancient languages may be saved. This app can fall into the good category because all the developing countries are in a very bad state. So like if we take an example, in Rome, Roman is a dead language. Nobody speaks, or the Roman is a very less spoken language. So we may preserve other languages by using my application. My reason to pick up this idea was a personal encounter. In my family, only my grandmother knows how to read, write, and speak in Sanskrit. My mother, father, and me, myself, don't know how to. So I want to change that ideology and bring Sanskrit to this pride of our nation, India. My research data and metrics suggest that Sanskrit is not a dead language, but it is the least spoken language in our country. So these are the seven villages where it is spoken. Mattur in Karnataka, Jiri in Madhya Pradesh, Sasana in Orisha, Bhaguar in MP, Ganoda in Rajasthan, Mohad in Madhya Pradesh again, and Hosahalika in Karnataka. There is one more village in Bihar where Sanskrit is a primary language, but I don't recall the name, so I have written there. Sanskrit is a very scientific language. The next generation supercomputers are going to be programmed and planned in Sanskrit language, as NASA believes it is the most easily understandable language by the computer. But in India, the government didn't promote this wonderful language. That's the reason why it comes to the end in most of our states. But maybe in the next few decades, it will become a dead language if we do not preserve it by making every citizen of our country aware of it by my app-based idea. So usage of my AI. For example, if Hindi in India got extinct or is near extinction, then my app would tell all the humans on the planet about this. Then this will indirectly be spread to the governments by social media, news, etc. Once the government notifies all the schools in the world teaching talking, writing, reading Hindi or any other language which may be near extinction in any other country or India only, would become normal. Those languages would again come to the normal way, and this way my app will help to recover the language. To summarize, in India, the population is approximately 1.38 billion. If 50% of the population relies on Hindi language, and if Hindi is wiped out, communication will become a main big problem. So let's not hinder this anymore and hunt near extinction languages and save them. Thank you. Hari Om.
It was Adish, right?
Yes, Prabhuji.
Yeah, Adish, you started with a good idea, preservation of extinct languages. Okay, so the idea is idea is you have to work on that. Okay, it is not in a shape for a application. So language becoming extinct, right? It is not language becoming extinct we have to recognize, but language becoming extinct you have to preserve. That is the challenge. So you give example of a lot of people speaking Hindi, and Hindi becoming extinct. So the AI is not something which we can do, which is required for that. AI is required to preserve what is being spoken of. If, let's say, Sanskrit today, we started with a good thing. Sanskrit, if it has to be preserved, what is to be done is AI. Not to say that Sanskrit is becoming extinct, that is not the challenge.
So the challenge is to preserve. So I had to make the PPT about how we can preserve it.
How your app can help people to study, learn Sanskrit, talk Sanskrit, or use Sanskrit.
Okay.
And you have to focus on one thing. You should not go to Africa and other countries. Even Hindi you should not bring in. You should focus just, you have taken right problem, Sanskrit. Focus only one problem. Okay, because see, we don't know what is there in Africa. We don't know what is there in any other country. And Hindi will not become extinct because Hindi is spoken by many people. So that is not at all a challenge. You have identified Sanskrit as a challenge, correct. Then focus on that. How you can teach people Sanskrit, people can learn Sanskrit, how people can use Sanskrit.
Yes, Prabhuji, I'll work on that. Thank you.
Yes, I think Guruji said is very correct. We should be very concrete and implementation specific about the idea. Let's say we are saying that we are going to use AI to promote the usage of Sanskrit. Then how are we going to do that? What are the aspects that AI will solve in this problem? And you know, details of the implementations is what we are looking for here. Some of the data that you are providing is okay, but at the same time, a lot of details about the implementation, one. Second is, you know, we can also think about how is the idea unique. If you are thinking of the idea or problem in this way, that means a lot of other people will also think about similar problems, then what is the unique proposition we are bringing here? Because if you look at the judging criteria, one of the criteria is innovativeness, and second is the buildability. What sort of AI you can use to build this idea? So as much implementation specific and practical we are about the problem, more effective the solution would be. Yes, let us move to the next one. I think on the top of the list is Venkat. You want to go next?
Uh-huh. Thawal, I don't think we have anybody, Venkat.
Vineet, I think. Vineet.
I think it's Vineet.
Okay.
Yeah, I'll begin. One second. Is it visible?
Yes, Vineet.
Okay. So I thought of calling it the Aqua Monitor, the smartest water monitor of all time, a farmer's true best friend. Okay, yeah. It provides the farmer with essential information ranging from telling them when to water their plants to even suggest water their crops, to even suggesting them on what crops can be grown in their land. I couldn't find out which category it falls into. I will just get that done. And why did I take up this problem in the first place? I've seen that farmers don't water their plants efficiently. Therefore, they face several problems. And several farmers do not have abundant water resources, and hence it is very important to use their water efficiently. So basically, my idea helps farmers to use their water efficiently, and so nothing gets wasted. I myself have wondered how much and when should I water my plants in our balcony. Some plants need less water while others need more. So farmers water their crops not being aware whether it's required or not. Other farmers who don't have enough water lose their crops because they choose the wrong crop. So my product solves two problems. Number one, when and how much water is required for the plants. And number two, what type of crop should be grown in a place. There are several parameters to be taken into consideration when we are deciding when to water a plant and how much should be there. So number one is the soil type, atmospheric temperature, amount of moisture present in the soil, and type of plant being grown. So this can tell us how much water and when should we water these plants. Usage of AI. AI can identify how much water must be watered because it can see the average. So it can see like after a while, after quite some time, it can decide and giving an average, a better result compared to others. And there's already a product called a water moisture monitor, soil moisture monitor. So it checks how much moisture is present in the soil, but that's not enough because if we have a sandy soil, and if there's quite some water when you put the monitor, in a few days it'll all be gone because the soil is different. Whereas the same one with the clayey soil will be even better, and it will stay for a long time. So there are some variables, and for that this can use AI can cut that down and give even accurate results and telling the farmers how much and when to water their plants. And one may ask, why do you need this product when you already have an indicator which can tell the farmers when to water their plants? So these indicators only take the consideration of atmospheric condition and moisture present in the soil. But our idea can take the also takes consideration of the type of soil present in that area and also the type of crop being grown. And these parameters are very important. And that's why it can give an even more accurate output on how much water is needed for the plants. That was my idea.
Vineet, good. Sounds good. How do you get the data? What data is required for this? Where do you get the data for? And moisture. Atmospheric moisture.
Yeah.
Those things
so there is already that, right? There is already some device which can check that out. So based from that, we can derive the information. I can show that in a while.
Do you have access to that device?
Oh yeah. It's easily available. It's not so rare. Shall I'll put it in.
I also have a couple of questions. One is that you said based on the research. So what is the source of that research? Where did you get that data? that these are the parameters on which you know it depends.
Yeah, so I checked out a website on how does that water monitor actually work, and then I just found that they check the atmospheric temperature, which is the humidity around, and they just check the soil, water present moisture in the soil. So only those two is what they use, but there are other parameters which are important.
Okay. And second is, you know, the determination of the category is very important. We will definitely need to consider which category this falls into, whether it falls into AI for Earth, because the rest of the categories are more or less, you know, pretty specific. So we need to definitely ensure that it falls into one of the categories, otherwise that becomes a problem.
So what category do you think this would fall in? Because I'm not so clear. I think it's Earth, but I'm not fully clear on that.
Yeah, it's I mean, it's supposed to help farmers, for my understanding, which will be, you know, slightly borderline. I am not sure if that will be considered as AI for Earth. We need to ensure that it is the case. Otherwise,
may you please tell the categories again, the five categories?
Yeah, I guess it's AI for accessibility, AI for cultural heritage, AI for Earth, AI for health. Just let me quickly look at it.
AI for humanity.
AI for human.
Yeah, humanitarian efforts. Yeah. So humanitarian. Yeah, that might be also one thing.
Only accessibility.
I think it falls under the AI for Earth.
Yes, Guruji. Yes, but
yeah,
I mean,
that's what I thought.
Earth, farmers, I mean, let's see, you know, if it's going to be a problem. Earth, I was thinking, is more like for
environment.
Nature,
which directly like benefit Earth. Yeah, okay. But well, let's see.
It's, see, farmers are, you know, the instruments in growing that, and he's helping the farmer, but finally, it's about, you know, how to bring out the best crop using the soil and the water resources, all the resources. So mostly doing with Earth, right?
Yeah. Yeah, we can definitely think about that. Another good idea, since it is using AI, is that, you know, AI can also analyze the environmental data and suggest the water mechanism according to that, because that would be weather data will be available and weather forecast will be available, which is something that usually farmers would not be able to do it on their own.
Yep.
Okay, very nice. So I will note this down. So have you self-rated this idea based on the judging criteria?
No, that's the, I didn't do it. I'll do that and I'll put it in the group.
Yeah, you can also do that. Okay.
Yeah.
You have to check up whether that water sensor data can be integrated with the app, because what type of output?
Yes. So I just saw it and it gives out like, what is that, 8-segment output or something like, it has lines like what we see in our microwave, which gives out an output. So I thought that could be, because I had worked with that in once, not with this, but the display. And I think that display could be connected to a software or something. It's possible.
May not be as simple as that.
Oh, okay. I don't know, because I have not done it physically, but the display is, I know how it looks. I can send a pic of that.
Okay.
Great. Let's move on to the next one. Aditya.
My video can't be turned on because I'm connected to a hotspot. There is no Wi-Fi in our house.
Oh, okay.
So I'll try sharing screen.
Yeah.
1 minute, sir. Sir, it's not sharing screen, but I made the PPT. Can I share my idea without sharing?
Go ahead.
Yeah, please go ahead.
So I made an AI app, which is medicine delivery and prescription uploading by the doctor. So what the basic idea is about is it's an idea about an app which delivers medicine to old and disabled people who cannot buy... who cannot buy it by themselves. So the idea falls into the AI for health category. So my inspiration for this idea came from, so I've seen an old people from old age homes who've been just left there buying medicines for themselves when they are still very sick. So I have thought about this idea. So research I made, and I made a conclusion that the app itself cannot identify and upload which medicine the people need. So the doctor must upload a prescription to the app to deliver the medicine by contacting the main stores nearby. That's what the app does. So the whole app is basically AI, from uploading by the doctors to the order gone to the nearest shop. Everything except the delivery. Yeah, that's it, sir.
How is it different from so many online delivery systems are there right now? Okay, so for example, I can order from a medicine, any medicine from home right now.
Yeah.
So how is it different from that?
But Prabhuji, sometimes like usually we might select the wrong medicine and things like that. There's many types of names we don't know. So right. That's why the doctor uploads it by himself by using the prescription. And it must be authorized with the doctor's signature.
Yeah, even this online portals, no, they require a prescription to be uploaded.
Yeah. Oh.
See, the my house, I get always medicine delivered.
Okay.
Online portal where we have to upload the prescription.
Oh, okay.
So you have to check, see so many online portals are there for medicine delivery.
Yeah.
I think already the solution exists.
Okay. So can I come up with another idea?
Yeah, you can come up, but you check up. There are so many medical portals are there which will deliver medicine at home with the uploaded prescription.
Okay, Prabhuji.
Okay, see for some other idea. Huh?
Yeah, I also want to call out that, you know, there is not really AI involved in this idea. AI is something that would learn on the go and, you know, modify the way an app works based on that learning. So, you know, if it is a simple, if this, then that would not be AI. AI would involve some sort of learning and refining the behavior of the app or the system based on that learning. All right. So the next one is Bhuvan.
Dhaval, Bhuvan is trying to fix his audio, it seems. Can we go to the next participant?
Yeah. Jeeva.
One second, I'm trying to...
Hello?
I'm trying to...
Yeah, sure.
How do you share the screen? Can I know how to share the screen?
There should be a green share screen button at the bottom.
I am actually on the mobile, so it's finding it tough.
See this? I'm actually not able to do it, so can you see this?
Yeah.
Yeah. So
you can stabilize the mobile though, so that.
So my idea is this is called a defying glass. So it helps the blinds to see. And so the thing is, my vision, it helps the blinds to see, and they know what is in front of them because they cannot see, and it helps them a lot. There is also some kinds of glass which helps the blinds to see, like partially see, but that's very expensive. What mine does is I'm using AI. It sees what's in front of them, analyzes it, and tells them how much steps they go. It also analyzes their footsteps as they go, so that they know how much the steps they should take and know where to go. They can also set a GPS if they want to go to the nearby store or home and come back easily, and some songs for entertainment because they can't see. And my goal is, there also, like as I said, there's also glasses which are very expensive, but I want mine to be cheap and available to all publicly. Thank you.
So, is Jiva? It was Jiva?
Yes, Guruji.
Yeah, Jiva, your idea seems to be good. Huh? It uses a mobile phone and tells blind person how far is the object, right?
Yeah, they can use the mobile, or they can use I think it's like they can hold a mobile. No, I thought of a glass. They can wear a kind of a glass which has a small camera in the front which can analyze everything. And another small belt camera near the belly, so that they don't trip and fall while they're walking, and tells them what is in front of them.
Creating a glass is quite a complex job. I don't think it is in the scope of what we can do.
Okay.
Because it invests a lot of investment and a lot of research.
Yeah.
What is possible or possible to think is using a mobile phone.
It's good.
Camera of the mobile phone.
Yeah.
The blind person can get an idea about the object. Maybe that may be something, a sound idea.
Okay, Guruji, I'll try to improvise it.
Yeah, anyway, let Dhaval give the feedback.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I think Guruji is very right here. Creating new hardware is very tough. Wherever possible, we should try and, see if we can use a mobile. Say, for example, if you know there are virtual reality cardboard props available by Google. So, one has to put their mobile here and wear that thing over in order to see in the mobile. So in the same way, even for these glasses, the mobile can be put in that, and the app in mobile will read them out what's going on. But that being said, apart from the hardware part, also check on the uniqueness part of this idea. It should be that the idea should be unique. So research if it is implemented already, by somebody else.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, so Jairam,
I'll can I share the screen now?
Yeah. Hi, Jairam.
1 minute. It's can I keep my video off? It's like there's little network problems.
Sure, that's fine.
My idea was like using AI for making traffic signals more easy. Like in India, even if the traffic is very less, it we have to wait until the timer ends. Like it does not, 1 minute. It does not see how much traffic density it is there and does not take the timer. It all, and like in, they have fixed the timer for the traffic signals. We can use AI to calculate the density, traffic density. And the AI will calculate the how much time is required for the way, how much time is required for the traffic signal to change, like how much time is required for the traffic signals. That's it.
Yes, Jairam, it looks like a good idea. Calculating the traffic, and also what happens is that traffic lights in multiple places can exchange information so that the flow of traffic can be smoothened. But I think it's a right direction to think.
Okay.
Dhaval?
Yeah, Guruji. One thing I'm thinking is like, where is the solution going to lie? Like if it's going to be, with the traffic lights, is the solution going to be somewhere within the software that operates the traffic lights? How are we going to work on a solution? I mean, we can think of a workflow about this, but
It's a traffic light solution.
Yeah, so probably in that case, the software that controls the traffic lights, which is going to be an embedded software, I guess, is where this work needs to be done.
Yes.
And second is like which category this falls into.
For accessibility.
No. AI for accessibility is for helping disabled people.
So, Dhavalji, I think this may fall into humanitarian action.
No, it doesn't.
Yeah, so we need to justify this idea in one of the categories as well. I mean, closest I can think of is AI for Earth, but that also is like borderline. Yes, Guruji. I mean, we can say that, it reduces the pollution and all, but still it's not directly related to AI for Earth. So categorization is another challenge here. Okay, cool. So let's go for idea.
What should Jairam do? We have to tell him.
I think categorization, Jairam, please think about that. It needs to clearly fall into one of the five categories. Otherwise, it's going to be a challenge to present.
What is AI for humanitarian?
Humanitarian action is when, say, for example, a disaster strikes and, AI helps them to manage the disaster in a better way. Or even, you know, the example that Microsoft gave for refugees and things like this.
Okay.
So, yeah, this is not.
Yeah, for example, let us say the COVID situation was there now. In the COVID, lot of workers were going from Bangalore to one city to other city, right? Some person loses his parents or relatives, find them. They're all come under the humanitarian. Or how many people are getting food or not?
Yes. So we need to think about that as well. I mean, in case we cannot categorize it into one of the five categories, then we probably need to think of another idea. So both challenges, one is, you know, the category and second is the implementation.
Okay, Jairam?
Okay.
So if it's not in the category, then you have to find something in the category.
Yes.
Okay.
All right, so Mihir,
so this is my idea. It's an app to diagnose and treat Alzheimer's. So this is about this idea. As the name suggests, this app helps people diagnose themselves, help them combat it. This app would fall under the category of AI for health and AI for accessibility. So why did I pick this idea? I personally found it sad that in this busy world, no one gets time for regular health checkups. Chronic stress is also becoming common, and this can eventually lead to Alzheimer's if it isn't given any attention. Many people also don't have access to proper healthcare system that can properly treat fatal diseases. This results in loss of many lives that could have been prevented. Since people tend to be on their smartphones a lot, I thought an app could do the trick, and thus my idea was born. So what is Alzheimer's disease? Alzheimer's disease is a progressive, almost irreversible brain disorder that slowly damages the brain and destroys short-term memory, thinking skills, the ability to do simple tasks, and eventually destroys long-term memory and involuntary brain function. It mostly occurs in people above the age of 60 and can be caused due to bad lifestyle or family history. Worldwide, there are at least 50 million people living with Alzheimer's or another form of dementia. So how is AI used here? AI is used in many different ways. By collecting and using the data of your lifestyle, it can automatically give lifestyle suggestions. Using the data it is collected from the user, the app can evaluate on its own whether he or she is at risk of Alzheimer's or not. Based on this data on how bad the symptoms of Alzheimer's are, the app will recommend games or puzzles on varying difficulty levels. For example, decrease in difficulty level when the condition is bad and send warnings frequently to play the games or solve the puzzles. Seizures are sometimes one of the earliest symptoms of Alzheimer's. The front camera of the smartphone could be used to detect these seizures, and if a smartwatch happens to be connected to the phone, will give greater accuracy in detecting seizures. Here, AI is used to detect the seizures with the help of data from the front camera and the smartwatch, if any. And someone had suggested this idea before me, so credits to them. So this is my self-evaluation. So innovation is 12 points, buildability 12 points, use of Microsoft technology 6 points, potential for impact 12 points, presentation of the idea 8 points, and ethical score 10 points. So that's it.
Mihir, your idea seems to be good. Did you discuss with any doctors? Is this workable?
I feel it is workable, but I didn't discuss it with any doctors.
Right, you need to really talk to get experts in this field to talk. Those who are treating Alzheimer's, that type of experts we need to. Otherwise, we'll think that we know the know a solution, but the solution may not be relevant. Right, so doctors' inputs are required, whether it really works. Otherwise, your idea seems to be good. Then ability to detect a seizure through a camera may be not easy, because patient may be walking, suddenly he may get a seizure, so camera may not be operational. So belt, probably that watch or something which can capture some data and send it to mobile may be helpful. This is a field where a lot of input from the doctors are required before we can say if this will work or not. Are we clear?
Yes, Prabhuji.
Yes, Dhawal.
Yeah, same, Prabhuji, same feedback. We need to, for working on the AI ideas, wherever the domain expert knowledge is required, we should not probably work on it ourselves, rather connect to the field experts and the industry and, you know, work with them on that part. But I think otherwise, you know, I have no additional input here.
Mihir, do you have anybody friend or relative who is a doctor who can help advise in this?
I don't know.
You don't know. Any relative of yours is a good doctor who can help you on this?
I have a relative who's a doctor, but I don't know if he knows anything about Alzheimer's.
Talk to him. Get some help from him. Okay. So this is a specialized field. It requires input from the doctors to say whether it works and what makes work, right? Yes, AI can be used, definitely, what you are saying. Okay, so if talk to the doctors, or you can reduce the scope of the work. You can say that there are tests and checks, problem solving, which will help you to detect how mental condition is improving or deteriorating. That we can say. We cannot say definitely about Alzheimer's, but we can use that test to see the mental ability increase or decrease over a period of time. Right?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. So I guess you can do two things here. One is, like Guruji says, connect to any doctor that you know, even if they are, a physician, because they will have some idea about Alzheimer's, any doctor will have idea about Alzheimer's, and they will be able to give you pointers to work with that idea. Second is also check if there are AI apps that deal with this problem, not necessarily to stop working on this problem, but to get some idea of how the apps deal with this problem. It will give you some inspiration, what sort of work the apps do that you can think of. And for the tests, check an app called, I'll send you, I'll paste this in the chat history. There is an app called Dual and Back, which is let me paste it again in the chat. Dual and Back, which is around the memory testing. So that is the app used for checking memory agility of somebody.
Mihir, what you have to do is you have to split the problem into two parts. The part one is testing of the ability of the brain. Okay. Let it not be Alzheimer. Somebody, okay, I want to test my ability of brain. I get a score of 8 by 10. After 5 years, I'll get 7 by 10. So I understand my brain is deteriorating. So it is not definitely, we cannot diagnose and say it's Alzheimer, because to say something is Alzheimer is very complex. But you can say some puzzles and problems which will help to detect the ability of the brain. That is one part. And to relate it to Alzheimer's, we cannot do it easily. We need to get a medical opinion. Are you getting what I'm saying?
Yes.
I think you have to work in two parts, part one and part two. Part one is ability to detect the ability of the mind, ability of the brain, like memory, agility, speed, okay, arithmetic ability, and then maybe memory recall, all those things you should as one part, which is memory, ability of the test of the brain. Second part is that you can track after 1 month, after 6 months, what will happen to me, even for a healthy person. Now, whether he's leading to Alzheimer's, to say that it's not easy, because people get scared. No, we need to get an opinion from the doctor. What is really Alzheimer? Can we relate to that? So if you split the problem into two, probably even problem one, part one of the problem itself is a solution. Are you getting what I'm saying?
Yes, Prabhuji.
Okay.
Great. Now let's move to the next person, Rajat.
Dhaval, Rajat wanted to do in the last.
Oh, okay.
Setting up system, yeah.
Yeah. Rochan.
Yes. Yes, sir.
Yeah, can you go ahead with your presentation?
I didn't made any presentation. I will say.
Sure. You can tell out your idea.
I have gotten the idea to scan this disease, skin diseases. With the help of camera, we can scan the disease, who got the skin, and we can say what is the disease, and to reduce it, we can upload some videos and we can make some exercises. The app is for detecting the skin disease.
Okay. Through app.
Who is speaking now? Who spoke? Roshan? Is it Roshan who spoke?
Yes, Prabhuji.
Okay. So now, to detect the skin diseases, some skin diseases are easy to detect.
Yes, Prabhuji.
Some skin diseases are difficult, right?
Yes.
Many skin diseases require a blood test also. It may not be just available to a camera.
Okay, Prabhuji.
Right? It is like some diseases, yes. Some diseases are maybe very. We can't say which disease is possible. Which disease? There are hundreds and hundreds of skin diseases, okay, and variety of symptoms, and many of them. Some of them skin diseases are not skin diseases actually. For example, somebody has a fever, okay. Some color of the skin may change. It's not a skin disease, but some other thing is giving rise to that symptom.
Okay, perfect.
You got it? So okay. To detect what is a skin disease, which type of skin disease is very difficult with the app, because it's a very specialized field.
Okay.
If you have a specific skin disease which can be detected, probably that will be simplify the problem.
Okay.
One type, because there are hundreds and hundreds, thousands of types. So you can say, okay, one type of skin disease I can detect and help the problem. It may be simpler. But even then, for that, you need to get advice and help from somebody, dermatologist. Do you know any dermatologist?
No, Prabhuji.
So it's a very specialized field. It is not easy to work on that unless we know so many varieties of diseases are there. Right?
Okay.
And also skin disease is not necessarily skin disease. Something related to stomach upset may lead to some rash on the skin. It may be that the cause and effect may not be skin disease, something else. So okay. to work on this problem, you need a guidance from a dermatologist. In case you have some guidance from dermatologist, then only you can think of.
Okay, Prabhu.
Okay, so what is that? Gayatri, you are saying something?
Guruji, I just had a suggestion to this. That's all.
What is the suggestion?
No, so even if the skin, you've said, even if the skin comes due to a stomach upset or a fever or anything, we can classify it under symptoms. If suppose the skin becomes pale or if it becomes a different color, then the AI can be like, okay, fine, the skin has become this color. If you take a camera and scan it, the skin has become this color. So it will come, it is possible that under such diseases, the person might have has the possibility of having such diseases like that.
Yeah, but it's a problem in the medical field. Okay, it's very, very complex.
Yes.
Because the dermatology is a very specialized field. There are thousands and thousands of diseases. Each of them have a symptom, and many, many skin diseases may not be possible to diagnose with the skin camera. It may require a blood test, all diagnostics.
Yes. So I know all this, but all I was just saying is that even if such a thing happened, if the skin changes due to another reason other than the directly from the skin itself, there are, we can also classify them under other diseases. But since the diseases, the scale is very large, it should be a large project. I mean, the code would be, we can say it would be quite huge.
Not only huge, we should not attempt this
without any medical assistance.
Yeah, a dermatologist or a specialized expert in dermatology should be available for us. Otherwise, we cannot attempt this.
And Prabhuji, even to program all those thousand types of skin diseases, it will take a lot of effort.
No, we can. That's why I'm saying, if you are able to restrict it to one or two types of diseases, possibly yes.
Yes, that is a good idea. That I think, yes, Guruji.
Yeah, but then even to do that, you need a good guidance from a good dermatologist.
It's a very good advice from the dermatologist.
Yes.
Yeah, and one more thing I want to call out here is the part of innovation when we are self-rating the projects. We should, when we have this kind of ideas, we can also search whether somebody has solved this already. There are institutes consisting of doctors and software engineers and other kind of scientists who work on such kind of solutions already. So if we say, for example, search for this particular problem, we see that this kind of an app is already available because of collaboration between a lot of AI scientists and software engineers and doctors. So while, even if we may be able to work on this, the rating on innovation would go down. So that would be one more thing to note as well. So that's why, thinking of local problems or thinking of something that is closely associated with you will increase the uniqueness of the idea. The broader it is, it is highly likely that somebody else is already working on it or is kind of solving this problem out there. All right, so let's go to the next one. Sahithi?
Yes, so I'll just share my screen.
Yeah.
Uh,
Are you able to see it?
Yeah.
Okay. So here I come up with my concept. Do it right. As you have seen the slide, you may have guessed it right. Yes, it is about health and fitness. Have you ever taken physiotherapy sessions, done yoga or some exercise, or plan to do it? If yes, then this one's for you. It's time to sweat and shine. AI for health. How many people have the time to physically go to fitness classes every day, particularly in this COVID or non-COVID scenario? Even if they do, how much individual attention are they going to get in a group from a trainer? How many of us can afford a personal trainer every day? After your paid physiotherapy sessions, were you able to work on yourself exactly in the same way as your therapist? Lack of personal attention is the main cause people may experience sprains and pains in the body. Let me tell you some of the most surprising statistics. 56% of US yogis are beginners. An average yoga practitioner spends almost $90 a month on yoga. So if they use this app, we can help them save $90 a month. 1 in 5 adult yoga users reported at least one acute adverse effect in their yoga practice, and 1 in 10 reported at least one chronic adverse effect, mainly musculoskeletal effects. Adverse effects were associated with hand, shoulder, and head stands, and with yoga self-study without supervision. Many people suffer pain and soreness when practicing the doctor's suggestions of physiotherapy at home. Have you ever experienced a neck sprain, a muscle sprain, or a torn ligament after the workout, self-physiotherapy, or dance? Why do you think it is? This happens because of the wrong practice of doing the right thing, the wrong posture, or because you have learned it long ago, or gap in practice or wrong training, or the training may not be customized as per your individual health condition. Lack of individual attention by the physical trainer when in a group. The same postures may not apply to every age group. The physical trainer may not be with us for every session. The physical trainer may ignore your wrong moves, and it can also be because of online training. Here I produce an idea of doing the right thing in the right way, customized to your age, gender, health condition, and body type. Through this, you can do your workout, take physiotherapy session, take Zumba or aerobics or dance class at your convenience, but in the perfectly right way. Here's the solution. I hope you observe what's going on here. Okay. So the previous slide shows a person doing workout using the Do It Right app. What does this app do? This app can clearly see how much you are at the same pace with the person on the screen. The trainer here is the AI. It exactly copies the trainer's or therapist's style and shows you if you are doing it right or wrong. Limb to limb, joint to movement is joint to joint movement is observed and flagged. If you are wrong, the screen displays an alert saying mismatch. If you get the alert if it is mismatched until the time you do it right. So it teaches you till the time you do it right. How it works. This is only a raw viewpoint, and many ideas can be added or modified as we really start working on this. So all you have to do is enter your full length photo and fill in your gender, age, weight, body mass index, health condition, and medication, if any, and body type. Optional, the computer can suggest the main toning areas or take manual toning suggestion and workout time. You can play this on your TV or computer with webcam. There will first be warm-up exercises where it will be in a slow pace to ensure body flexibility. Body recognition, every limb movement recognition, and voice recognition is enabled. There will be full body image capture, and the workout video and the full body image appear on the same screen. When you say start, the video plays. Okay, why do we need this app? As we all know, it's a healthy mind and a healthy body. And when you're anywhere doing the right thing, just know the right way to do it. Who needs this app? Everyone, starting from a teenager, an employee, an employer, a housewife, a working woman, an entrepreneur, and an old person needs this app. When do they need this app? Now and ever. The Do It Right app aims to reduce human error caused by the trainer's fatigue, lack of individual attention, reduces the patient's error during self-physiotherapy in following the doctor's instructions, reduces the human effort for dance tutors or PT trainers. So guys, this is just the beginning of the end. Thank you.
Yes, Saiti, your idea looks good. Are there any such ideas available in the market? Did you check up?
Sorry.
What
was your question?
Yeah. Is there anything available in the market which will do like this?
I'm not sure.
Okay. You have to check up when any solutions are available.
Okay.
So basically, what you are saying is AI-based physical fitness trainer. That's what you're saying.
Yes. Yes. Exactly.
Right. AI-based physical fitness trainer.
Mm-hmm.
To me, idea seems to be good. To implement it for a complex series of training moves may be difficult. If you have to implement it, probably one posture, one activity, you may do it and show the proof of concept.
Okay.
So for me, you can check the innovativeness, whether somebody else is doing it and who else is doing it. Okay. Otherwise, I feel it is it can be a good idea.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Right? It could be applied to even not necessarily physical training. It could be applied to dance moves also.
Yes, exactly.
Right? Somebody wants to learn a dance, you can do that.
Yes.
This particular idea, what you are saying, seems to have a lot of potential. But mm-hmm. We should not make it too general and to try to do too many things. You can take one posture, maybe one asana, and try to show how it works.
Yes, yes.
Yes, Dhaval?
Yes, Guruji. I think that's you said the crux of the matter. One is the video analysis would be complicated. So we can focus on one posture. Otherwise, the idea is quite good.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
So, Saiti, have you undergone any physical training, physical fitness training like this?
Online training, no, Prabhuji.
So how did you get this idea?
I'm basically interested in dance, as you all know, and we try to aim for perfection. So this app helps you to gain perfection.
You can instead of physical fitness, you can as well convert it to a dance.
Yes, yes, we can.
Okay, so you can. My suggestion is you focus on the dance.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, take one posture and one set of dance steps. Don't make it a very big dance and all.
Okay. Yeah.
Try to see whether you can implement to artificial intelligence.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Okay. So the idea is same, the physical, instead of physical fitness, because it's not your domain, but dance is your domain.
Yes, yes.
So take dance steps.
Okay. So
let's say take three or four steps of dance, not many.
Okay.
And then that three or four steps, somebody should be able to learn through this app. That would be a great achievement.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Okay.
Yes, Prabhuj. Thank you.
Also, it's a good idea. This is something which has a potential. Okay, somebody or other body will develop on this idea and it will become a good idea.
Yes, yes.
Yes. So next is Sarvesh.
Hello, sir. Can I just explain my idea? I haven't done my PPT yet.
Sure, you can explain.
I just got access to my Google Classroom today only. So
Yeah, you can explain the idea.
My idea is AI for health. I have to know the nutrition aspects of a food product. So as you see, every food and every package of food has nutrition facts at the back, right?
Yes.
Suppose you didn't know what the words meant. And for example, polyunsaturated. I don't even know what that word means.
Mm-hmm.
So for that, I can make an app on the camera. As you see, Google Lens. It's usually, I got the idea from that, except it doesn't tell you what it is, but it tells you what kind of nutrition facts is in it, protein and everything added to the product. So this is also a good idea for doctors who prescribe medicine, like if you need iron contained in your body, and suppose they say you need to eat dates, but you don't know actually what type of dates you need to eat. So you might as well as, you know, get like some dates, and you can picture this and it will tell you all the iron content and everything in it. So that's my idea.
Okay.
Sarvesh? Yeah, Sarvesh, at the outset, I think it's a very good idea. Okay, at the outset, it looks very good idea. So who uses this? It's a patient or is anybody uses this, right?
Anybody can use this.
See, for example, I myself face a challenge. Okay, I am a diabetic patient. Okay, so I go to a store and try to buy a product, and there will be some sucrose, fructose, something will be mentioned. I don't understand. Now, if I am able to scan that nutrition table and map it to my disease and say whether it's suitable for me, it's a great help.
Yes.
So your idea seems to be having a wide range of applications. But let us say, for the purpose of simplicity, let us restrict the scope, means reduce it, and say for initial experimentation, we'll say food which is required for diabetic. And he'll scan a label and say whether the food is good, food is okay or not okay for him. Or somebody who has some medical prescription has, rather medical a disease has to be mapped to the label on the food item, and give advice. That may be a good step. Let us say just restrict it to, let us say, diabetes now, or heart disease. So something may be useful. That's what I'm thinking.
Okay, Guruji.
So Dhaval?
Yes, Guruji. Very good application. You know, plain information may not be that useful, but if we can connect it to diseases, that is very effective.
So Sarvesh, you should focus on one type of person, okay? Not all the type, right? For example, you can take a pregnant woman, okay? What are the nutrients required for pregnant woman? Are there in that food item? You can say and you can advise, possibly. Or for a diabetic patient, you can map and say this is okay or not okay. Basically, mobile phone, you should be able to scan that label, and the AI should tell you the information.
Yes.
Right? Don't make it too wide. I mean, it is useful, applications wide, but you should narrow down to, so that one thing which you can demonstrate, we should work on a solution which you can showcase to people.
Okay.
Right. So do you have any doctors or anybody who can help you in that understanding, mapping?
No, Prabhuji, I don't. No.
How did you get this idea?
This idea actually, you know, many patients, you know, how do we say this?
No. How did you find this idea? I mean, how did you get this idea?
Actually, me and my mom talked about what idea and what. I needed to do, you know, something for the community or anything that human or accessibility can use, or so that's why I chose to give medical information of a product. So suppose like, and also it can also find any, like, you know, if suppose I can take chicken, mm-hmm. if that chicken is good or bad, I can check it.
How do you know?
Because of the app.
No, app, how will it tell that chicken is good or bad?
With the camera on the phone?
That is difficult, no?
Yes.
Because the food items, I agree, because there's a label which is put on the food items. in that label some carbohydrate and whatever is in, yes, it is there. Now you can map it to a specific disease and say it's workable or not workable. But to find out whether chicken is good or vegetable, let's say I want to buy baingan or tomato. Is tomato good or not? By looking at the app, I don't think it is maybe a right solution.
Okay, Papaji.
So I would suggest that you take, you imagine you go to a food store and try to buy something and there is a label on that, right? Each of them has a label, right? So yes. Scan that label, and with that label, you can map it to one disease, like let's say diabetes or something, and suggestion whether it's okay or not okay, something like that. Maybe yes.
Okay. At the end, as you see, Google Lens, it is made by Google that it is also found in your camera that if you take any picture of any like item or stuff, it actually shows you the picture and web results of stuff. This app is basically like that, but except it tells you the nutrition values of that product.
Exactly. Okay, it's a very good idea, but you have to focus on a specific problem. Maybe food item for the child, or maybe food item for a diabetes, something like that.
Yeah.
Okay. I think it's a good idea, a good potential.
Okay.
But you have to narrow down, okay? You have to work out specifics. Okay, good.
Okay, thank you.
All right. So now we have Siddharth.
Yes, Prabhuji. Yeah, 1 minute. So can you see it?
Yeah.
So it's about helping diagnose diseases for on a professional level using doctors, and mainly for professional medical professionals. So basically, it's where diagnosis from people of the past, where patients from the past, their symptoms and their conditions are input into the algorithm, and the algorithm learns what symptoms exist for different diseases, and other marking factors which can classify the disease as one specific disease. And then when a new patient symptoms are input into the algorithm, it can provide probabilities about which disease is more likely for it to be. So it falls into AI for health, and it's basically on the premise that misdiagnosis is dangerous and treatment becomes harmful, especially when there are serious conditions. So this is the data I collected. So each year, over 12 million people receive a misdiagnosis. And then out of these, 28% are life-threatening or life-altering. And then 88% who ask for different opinions they get a changed diagnosis and different treatments. So even 44 types of some types of cancer are misdiagnosed. And so basically the main cause of this is fragmentation of care and overconfidence or inexperience in doctors. Fragmentation of care means when the patient goes to two different doctors or different professionals who have different levels of training, different opinions, etc. So they get two very different opinions. And then when they stick to one of them, it has a high chance of misdiagnosis. So that's fragmentation of care. And overconfidence or inexperience in doctors is also a huge cause of misdiagnosis. So having an AI to help in the diagnosis provides a uniform opinion, and can also, if the doctor's opinion differs from the AI's opinion, it can also encourage the doctor to recheck or run extra diagnostics on the patient. So in this, the algorithm would have learned the symptoms of the previous patients and their illnesses. So the symptoms of the new patient are fed in, and using that, it predicts the illness. With each new patient, the accuracy of the algorithm increases. And then with every new confirmed diagnosis, the results also get fine-tuned. So blood tests, MRI scans, CT scans, visual diagnosis, every tool that's available to doctors can be input into this to help in diagnosing, to train the algorithm, and also for further results. The training data will be second checked, double checked, and it will be ensure that it's as accurate as possible before inputting it into the algorithm. So this provides as accurate results as possible. So this is the evaluation of the different, the marking scheme from the rubrics. What I saw was that so far, similar applications have only been for specific cases. For example, detecting coronary artery blockage from pictures or detecting skin diseases, as was said earlier. But it's never been very generalized. And this could be a much larger scale approach and a broader approach because it would be much more helpful and scalable. It's very easily built because it's not a very... the data required could easily be handled by medical professionals or available from data online itself. It's available. And this can be modified if needed. For example, if a dermatologist or, say, a psychologist requires an opinion for this, the same algorithm can also be used for specific purposes or for specific diseases with little modification. And the main advantage of this is it'll be uniform and every doctor will have impartial opinions, which will be uniform. So that's the biggest advantage of this, because different doctors won't end up with different resources. So that deals with the fragmentation of care problem. And another concern is anonymity, because if the patient's data is being used for algorithm training, then their anonymity could be, their identity could be questioned. The fact of their personal information being shared comes into the question. So using this algorithm, you can also maintain anonymity by providing just the results. You don't have to provide identities or anything. And it won't replace human evaluation, but it's only a second opinion for the reasons provided earlier, that it encourages re-diagnosis and second opinions. That's it.
Siddhartha, this is like a medical expert system, right?
Yes, Prabhuji.
A medical field is a very, very complex field. Deep domain knowledge and expertise is required to cover all types of diseases, which is a very, very complex subject. And that is the reason why a comprehensive medical expert systems are not there, even with the professional doctors, because it's very difficult to obtain the data on variety of situations. And that is the reason very specific diagnostics are made. For example, maybe a coronary artery disease, as you said, or maybe even corona disease. So the problem is narrowed down because the field is too big and too vast.
But the thing is, with every new patient, you can keep adding symptoms and the diagnosis, and the algorithm will just, you don't have to input everything at once. But you just input, with every new patient, if you keep inputting it, and there's like a network for all the algorithms to connect with, then it'll keep growing with the medical field, because you don't have to provide everything all at once. Because if you just build the algorithm, it'll keep learning by itself when the medical professionals diagnose. So you don't need specialty knowledge all at once, but you can rely on the specialty knowledge of the different doctors to help the algorithm grow over time.
the input which is required for a doctor to diagnose comes from the symptom of the patient, then x-ray, then chest, this thing, where so many medical reports, blood test, and all those things. Will this algorithm take all those reports?
Yeah, so all of these factors can be used for helping the diagnosis. For example, if there's some kind of cancer, the AI, I mean, the picture of the cancer, for example, the MRI scan or CT scan can be uploaded, plus their blood test can be uploaded, their visual symptoms, any physical changes, all of that can be uploaded. So there's a lot of scope also, because it also refines it, because other cases, it might look similar to cancer, but it might not be cancer. So if the other symptoms don't match, then again, misdiagnosis can be avoided.
Do you have any doctors or anybody in your house who can advise you in this?
No, I don't know any doctors.
How did you get this idea?
This idea, it was because I was going through the previous year AI challenges, and then I noticed, especially in AI for health, it was very specific, and I mean, it was very specific and it won't benefit all those many people. But I got the idea of doing this so it would help as many people as possible.
I would no doubt it's a very, very suitable for artificial intelligence type of a challenge. Okay, no doubt about that. But only thing which I am worried about is that too much of complexity and variety of scenarios which are available in the medical field. Do you have the competence to understand that and evaluate that for our work?
I mean, for the project, you could make a very scaled down or simple version of it, like only for a couple of diseases, you could input different blood symptoms and physical symptoms, and that could be used to predict a few diseases. And then for the large scale one, it could be grown by itself by inputs by specialty doctors or stuff, people like that, over a long period of time. So it keeps getting more and more accurate, but we can start with a simple version.
Yes, Dhaval, what do you say? This is a typical AI challenge, no doubt about it.
Yeah. So, we can think of this from a completely different perspective. When you know, such a broad and complex idea, we think we can address in one go. Then why it has not been addressed already by so many field experts and doctors collaborating on this since such a long time? So what is it that we will be doing here that they have not been able to do so far?
I mean, I don't know exactly what development, exactly what, if
precisely. So in that case, we need to understand that if they have not been able to do it so far, either they would have been able to do it easily, you know, if it's a very easily addressable issue, then they would have been already working on this and have solved this already. So if they have not been able to do this, then why it is preventing them from doing so? What is the thing that we will do that they have not been able to do? So we need to find that part. I think Guruji is hinting at that, that the problem is not as simple as it sounds. It's a very complex problem. And to develop such a generic system that addresses a very broad area like entire healthcare is going to be a very complex challenge. So, broadly, I can say that AI can solve any problem. Yeah, that's possible. But then what is it that I am going to do in that particular aspect is going to matter. So I think you can probably think through this, like what exactly are you going to work on? How is it going to impact the existing problem? And what problem you are solving that nobody else has solved so far?
Okay.
So actually, if you are continuing on this, my suggestion is narrow down the problem, make it specific, then generalize in later. Okay, let us take the problem narrow down. Okay, for example, right now there are artificial intelligence systems which will diagnose for corona, right? So there are so many apps are there which will diagnose whether you have corona or chances of corona. Even to get an accurate diagnosis is not easy on the app. Let us define the problem in a narrower sense. We'll say somebody has a diabetes. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Whether a diabetic patient, a patient has a diabetic or not. Right. So now there are two parts. One is diagnosis and other is a prescription. So your solution is taking care of diagnosis and prescription, or only diagnosis part?
Only diagnosis.
So let us say narrow down the problem. Okay, make it specific. Okay, somebody is going for a diabetes test.
Okay,
diabetes test will have some blood test reports, some symptoms like thirst, hunger, or body weight, all those things, right?
Yes.
So with that type of data, can you diagnose somebody has a diabetes and what level of diabetes he has? Diabetes level 1, what is called diabetes 1, diabetes 2, they're called type 1 diabetes, type 2 diabetes, right?
Yes, Prabhuji.
So can you narrow it down so that one specific case we can test?
Okay, Prabhuji.
But you need some guidance of medical professional there. Do you have anybody? Otherwise, it'll be difficult for you.
No, I don't have, but I think you can get online resources also for symptoms and different testing and everything. There are lots of research online also about different kinds of medical cases.
But what happens is, these are all very specialized domain knowledges. A common people like us, right?
Yes, sir.
Taking that data, we may come to wrong conclusions.
Okay, Prabhuji.
Right. Of course, somebody's guidance is required. Do you have any guidance of any homeopathic doctor?
No, Prabhuji.
The problem definition what you have identified is correct only. Okay, it is very amenable to artificial intelligence, but it's a very complex project according to me. It's not simple.
Okay.
To reduce the complexity, make it simple. You have to identify one narrow area, one thing. I'll try it out and show that this works very good for this particular problem.
Okay, Prabhuji.
So it could be diabetes. Now, if you want to take diabetes, then what will you do? You'll take search online data and then try to use that data for diabetes problem.
Yeah, you could. Even diabetes or any other disease could work. Even diabetes or different kinds of fever.
No, what I'm saying is, we should think in terms of implementation, right? We should be able to implement in next 3 months, right?
Okay, Prabhuji. I can.
We should be able to show that it works in next 3 months. If you take a very complex problem, we'll never be able to show anything.
Yes, Prabhuji.
So you have to think of demonstrability. Okay, you should tell to somebody, yeah, this works. So for that, what you need to do, you think over.
Okay, Prabhuji.
Right? Yeah, don't make it a problem too general, because that too general is very complex. It has so many dimensions.
Okay, Prabhuji.
Start with a narrow solution, and that narrow solution we can gradually expand to a larger solution.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right. And lastly, Vishnu.
Yes, Dawaji. One second. Can you see my screen?
Yeah.
Okay. So, Hariom all. I am presenting my idea on how to solve real-time problems using artificial intelligence. And my idea is about how do we recognize the early symptoms of Parkinson's disease using AI in the early stages of this disease. So, let us know what exactly is Parkinson's disease. Parkinson's disease is a neurodegenerative disease which predominantly affects dopamine, which is an important neurotransmitter in the brain. This is an disorder which is caused by miscommunication between the neurons. This disorder was first identified and named after the British physician James Parkinson. My idea falls into the category of AI for health. So Parkinson's disease is one of the most deadly and life-threatening diseases, which is currently affecting 10 million people all over the world. The number of cases of Parkinson's may increase to 16 million by 2050. So this is a problem to be addressed. So I chose this idea and so that it can save the lives of millions of people all over the world. More than 10 million people all over the world live with Parkinson's disease. The number of cases of Parkinson's disease increases with the age. The people who are aged above 60 years are expected to have Parkinson's disease. Men are more prone to this disease than women. So financially, the treatment of one individual with Parkinson's disease can, on an average, cost $1 million for the complete medications. So what are the symptoms of this disease that makes it so fatal? Tremors and shaking can occur at rest in the hands and the limbs. Small handwriting. You may notice that the way you write the words on a page has reduced in size, and the letters and the words are crowded together. You may also have disturbed sleep. Sudden movements during the sleep may be a sign of Parkinson's disease. Inappropriate facial expressions such as a blank stare or a depressed look are signs of Parkinson's disease. There are mainly 5 stages that are involved in this disease. Stage 1 is the mildest form of Parkinson. Stage 2 is considered to be the moderate. Stage 3 is the middle stage in Parkinson, and it marks the major turning point in the progression of the disease. Stage 4, it is impossible to stand without assistance. However, you may need to use wheelchair or some other assistive device for movement. Stage 5 is the most advanced stage of Parkinson's disease. So how do we use AI for solving this problem? So almost 55% of the world is urbanized, and most of the people live in urban areas. Due to rapid technological advancements, most people use electronic gadgets like laptops and mobile phones. So we can use this to track and monitor the movements of the mouse or the cursor to help us in tracking whether the individual has tremors or shaking in his hands. We can also give them tests like drawing a line between two fixed points or drawing a circle or any shape. This helps us in knowing whether a person's hand is vigorously shaking or not by observing the drawn line which is drawn. We can also use a handwriting analysis to observe the reduction in the size of handwriting. Small letters and cramped words can also be detected using this handwriting analysis. We can also have a video tracker which tracks the rate of blinking of eyes as they reduce for an infected person. We can also have audio detectors which processes audio clippings by the individual and identify whether he has difficulty in speaking, as it is one of the symptoms. For all this, we need a large amount of data and information inputs from a professional doctor. The more amount of data we feed the AI, the more smarter it becomes, and more accurate the result it gives are. So we should build an AI that learns through the process. We should build an AI that will be a web application rather than an installed application, as web applications are more compatible and flexible, and large mass of people can reach out to it. That's it. Thank you.
Vishnu, you presented an idea for AI for Parkinson.
Yes, probably.
It is one of the possibilities, no doubt about it. It's like a diagnosing a disease. Now, it is a patient who has to use it, right? A person who has to use it. Let's say I am over 55 or 60, and I have to check whether I have Parkinson's once in a while. Is that what correct?
Yes, probably it's right.
So for that, many tests are possible, right? Handshake,
signature and many things.
Yes, probably.
And even if there is changes are there, to conclude that there is a Parkinson is very difficult. It's not easy.
Yes.
For example, because after the computers have come, my handwriting has gone bad. Right? I keep on working on laptop and my handwriting, I don't use my handwriting.
Okay.
So because of the handwriting goes bad. There can be many reasons for anything, right? To conclude, is Parkinson maybe difficult based on just symptoms alone?
Okay.
So for example, last 20 years, I have not written any single page because of working on laptop. Because of that, my hand shakes when I write even the signature.
Okay.
That is not necessarily a sign of Parkinson.
Okay, but we can conclude that a person has it based on other tests and checkups.
See, that's why for concluding anything, there are two conditions. One is necessary and sufficient.
Okay.
Do you understand what is necessary and what is sufficient?
No, probably.
So necessary condition and sufficient condition. For example, I'm just giving you a necessary, okay? To say, I'm giving an example. Let's say I have fruit, okay? I don't know what fruit is that. I'll ask you a question. For example, I have fruit. I'll say the color of the fruit is yellow. So tell me what fruit is that?
Okay, there can be many answers.
Right? So that is a necessary, what I have given is a necessary input. Without saying yellow, you can't find out. But it's not sufficient to conclude.
Okay, bro.
So what is required for you to conclude some fruit?
The taste of the fruit.
But the taste of the fruit you cannot give to this thing, computer, no?
Yes, Prabhuji.
Right? So for the taste is one thing, right? It can be a banana or it can be lemon, right?
Yes.
It can be banana or lemon or many other fruits. So there is always a necessary condition and sufficient condition. That means, these conditions are there. I can guarantee say that this is a lemon.
Okay.
Otherwise, I can't say, right? It will be uncertain, right?
Yes, probably.
So what are the necessary and sufficient conditions for Parkinson? This question is necessary and sufficient condition for all the people who are working on medical diagnostic type of problem, right?
Yes.
Somebody earlier spoke on medical diagnosis. So medical diagnosis also depends on necessary and sufficient condition.
Okay.
Okay. So then there is also, who worked on the medical diagnosis earlier? Who said somebody? No? Okay. So there is also what he called as uncertain logic. Logic which is fuzzy logic. So if I say yellow, it may be 20% chance that it may be banana and 50% chance maybe that is lemon or 30% chance maybe that it's another fruit from Africa.
Okay.
So variety of conditions will come, right?
Yes, Prabhuji.
Now in that condition to do a reasoning and conclude Parkinson may be a challenging task.
Okay.
We can only... in some diseases, yes, it can be. But in case of Parkinson, maybe you should say, I have two or three tests.
Yes, probably you have four tests.
Okay, let's say four tests. And if this four tests fail, you cannot say the person has a Parkinson. You may have a possibility of Parkinson. Nobody can, we cannot conclude that.
Okay.
Or you may say that, okay, you have to check up with doctor. You should not scare the patient saying you have Parkinson.
Correct.
Right? The patient may get worried that, I have Parkinson.
Yes, probably.
Unless you have a necessary and sufficient condition.
in medical diagnosis, that's a very big challenge, okay? Because patients will get worried. If you give a wrong diagnosis, they will start getting worried.
Okay, Prabhuji.
Right? In one recent case, I know a person who was suspected of corona. He was not even diagnosed for corona. And he died because of fear rather than corona. So that's one thing which you have to be careful in case of medical diagnosis.
Okay, Prabhuji.
Okay. So now with that, what do you want to do? You want to, I'm sure to conclude somebody has a Parkinson is going to be a big challenge because it requires a lot of data and parameters. And also even with that, to conclude that somebody has a Parkinson may be not easy because necessary insufficient conditions you may not have.
Yes, Prabhuji.
Right. So how do you narrow down your scope of your project so that the project is something usable or doable?
Okay.
You got the problem? What I'm trying to say?
Yes, Prabhu. I got it.
Right? See, ultimately we have to prove, we are not doctors, right? We don't have any doctor's advice also, right? In next 2-3 months, you have to show this whole thing working. Otherwise, we will not be successful in this challenge.
Okay, Prabhu.
Okay, Dhawal.
Yes, Guruji, very true. All the health category problems are critical ones. So we need to think through them. And secondly, when we use AI for them, we also need to think about how do we or how are we going to train the models for them. So when we say that AI can detect Parkinson, that means initially we don't have enough data for that model to work accurately. So whether we will be training that model with a lot of people who have Parkinson already, so all those strategies also need to be thought about, which is not possible to think through without collaborating with a proper medical professional. So yeah, that's something from my side. Okay, and somebody else was pending. They wanted to prepare for presentation, and I guess I might have missed out on someone else as well.
Dhawal, did Bhuvan speak?
I think, yeah, he wanted to prepare.
So
Dhawalji, can I speak?
Yeah.
Okay, Dhawalji. Dhawalji, basically I've put most of my slides there are research data or metrics, Dhawalji. So in the 8th slide I've put the practical usage.
Who is speaking?
Rajat Prabhuji.
Hello, I'm Fury. I'm Rajath's PowerPoint presentation voice assistant and will help you read the text. Idea description. Lifestyle is a way used by people, groups and nations and is formed in specific geographical, economic, political, cultural and religious text. Lifestyle is referred to the characteristics of inhabitants of a region in special time and place. It includes day-to-day behaviors and functions of individuals in job, activities, fun and diet. In recent decades, lifestyle as an important factor of health is more interested by researchers. According to WHO, 60% of related factors to individual health and quality of life are correlated to lifestyle. 1. Millions of people follow an unhealthy lifestyle. Hence, they encounter illness, disability, and even death. Problems like metabolic diseases, joint and skeletal problems, cardiovascular diseases, hypertension, overweight, violence, and so on, can be caused by an unhealthy lifestyle. The relationship of lifestyle and health should be highly considered. Published February 28 in the journal Circulation, this is the first study to show the association of a healthy lifestyle maintained throughout young adulthood and middle age with low cardiovascular disease risk in middle age. In the US, at the beginning of the study period, about 26% of the sample were obese, 62% had smoked, 73% were considered heavy drinkers, 27% were in the low-risk category LRB1, all non-obese people who had never smoked, and 7% of the sample were in the low-risk category LRB2, non-obese people who never smoked and were moderate drinkers. Researchers used data collected over 20 years from the Coronary Artery Risk Development in Young Adults Cardia study. It began in 1985 and 1986 with several thousand 18 to 30-year-olds and has since followed the same group of participants. For this study, the researchers analyzed data such as blood pressure, cholesterol, blood sugar, BMI, alcohol intake, tobacco use, diet and exercise from more than 3,000 of the cardia participants to define a low cardiovascular disease risk profile and healthy lifestyle factors. If the next generation of young people adopt and maintain healthy lifestyles, they will gain more than heart health, the doctor stressed. Many studies suggest that people who have low cardiovascular risk in middle age will have a better quality of life, will live longer and will have lower Medicare costs in their older age, he said. There are a lot of benefits to maintaining a low risk profile. By analyzing the lifestyle, eating habits, fitness of the body and capacity, the machine provides a schedule to follow and a list of do's and don'ts. Based variety, achieve your fitness goals through customized coaching and actionable tips based on your health and the schedule provided. Flexibility, from swimming to strolling, any activity that gets you moving makes an impact on your health. Compatibility, track your progress from a gadget like a computer or a mobile. Why did I choose this? People at very young age suffer with diabetes, cancer and many other diseases which sometimes are very fatal. A 40-year-old man dies due to cardiac arrest. The specific reason can't be determined, says the doctor, but the core reasons will be the lifestyle, eating habits, and lack of physical exercise. People in the 1900s never suffered from such diseases in their 40s or 50s. Their lifespan would be at least 45 to 50% more than the present generation just because of their lifestyle and eating habits.
On a brief note, Dhawalji, I plan to make an AI that would track the lifestyle, eating habits and exercise routine of the person and determine a do and don't list by which he follows that, and his cardiovascular health and his mental health and his body health in a total will be better.
So basically, you are actually speaking of a lifestyle monitor.
Yes, Prabhuji.
A lifestyle monitor and okay, I will call it as lifestyle advisor.
Yes, Prabhuji.
So what? Who will give the what data has to be fed? Yes, no. Answer has to be fed by the person.
No, Prabhuji. It'll take the data metrics of the person on a daily basis and will analyze.
How does it take the data?
Prabhuji, he'll tell it in the way of a speech, and it'll recognize it as a text, and it'll analyze this text. By analyzing the text, it'll prescribe what to give and what not to give.
Okay, let us say today, I am there. Okay, now I have this app. So what should I do? Let's say, what will the app ask me some question?
Yes, Prabhuji, daily you should give a survey. What time did you wake up? What time did you eat your breakfast? Everything. Then it'll give you the list in the form of a PDF. What you should eat, what you should not eat, when you should get up, how much you should exercise, everything. Basically, I'm trying to tell that by changing the lifestyle itself, diseases will only not come.
No, I agree with you. It's called what is a preventive medicine or lifestyle advisor.
Yes, Prabhuji.
So, what are the parameters we take for lifestyle advice? Activity, physical activity, the food habits, all those things, right?
Yes, Prabhuji. And it'll as the AI read out, it'll have compatibility, versatility, and variety. By which versatility means you can ask it anything. Variety means from swimming, strolling, walking, etc. You can choose your exercise based on the list. And compatibility, you can track your progress from a computer or mobile.
Now, what progress do I track?
How much have I exercised? How much?
How much I exercise? I have to feed now.
Yes, Prabhuji.
I have to feed now. The computer, mobile will not find out. I'll have to feed the data. I exercise for half an hour today and all.
No, Prabhuji, how much it has prescribed, you should just tell that you completed. By that, on a monthly basis, it will show you your exact progress.
Okay. Let us say we have to implement this. Yes, Do you know what all the parameters we have to take?
Coding?
No. What are the input parameters for this? This, let us say, this app you have to make.
Yes, Prabhuji.
What parameters will ask from a person?
Prabhuji, parameters like what? Exercise, food.
Okay.
Exercise, food. What time does he wake up? How much does he exercise? And how much stress he bears, etc., etc.
Okay. How often he has to do?
Daily.
That is going to be too much, no?
No, Prabhuji, it will not be a burden on his daily routine, but it should affect his routine, because if he does something wrong, it will affect his health on a longer run.
Yeah, as a concept, lifestyle advisor, I think is a good idea. But we need to really refine and define the idea. What exactly is that, and how to make it work?
Okay, Prabhuji, I'll be more precise when I'm doing in the next time.
Dhawal?
Yeah, I think, and we can also check the uniqueness of this idea. Like, you know, there are a lot of trackers like Fitbit Sense that collect a lot of physical activity and body data metrics, as well as trackers like MyFitnessPal, etc., that helps with tracking as well. So tracking part is there. There are some other tools which do the AI part already. So we need to also check whether, you know, this is a very unique idea.
But Dhawalji, Google Fit and Fitbit Sense have a few of limitations.
Mm-hmm.
Like, they do not prompt you on doing this. This AI will prompt you, and this will motivate you. For example,
prompting is not the unique part, right? I mean, prompting is not something that we are solving through AI. Prompting is something not a part of AI.
Is the LG. But but in Fitbit sense, I don't think so. They have swimming and all, but but this can have anything, cycling, skating, etc. But according to your capacities and time you have, we can classify it into modes: a student life, a working life, and a senior life. Student life, most of the time there'll be at least some free time where he can give priority to his body. In the work life, there'll be more priority to the work, so the minimal exercise you can do, that will be prescribed. And in the senior mode, you can, as the person above 55 to 60 years, his body fitness is limited, so you can set some parameters for that. Parameters in the sense, you can set some limits.
Correct. Yeah, so I would say check if there is something similar already available.
I'll check double G by the next session. I'll tell you.
Sure.
Are we coming to an end, closure?
Yeah. Have we left out anybody?
Okay. Overall, I'm happy. Many of you have worked on good ideas. Some of the ideas are outright appear to be good. Some of the ideas require more refinement. Some of the ideas may not be practical, either because they don't belong to a category or practicality of implementation. Yes. Now, what is the next step, Dhaval?
So good thing is that, Guruji, we just need 2-3 ideas because we are going to work with a team structure. Right. So what I will do as a next step is compile all these ideas into a sheet. I'll create a sheet and send across in the group where we will have the list of the ideas, and we will have a voting thing going on as well. So we'll select top 2-3 ideas and then also refine the rest of the ideas. So let us have one iteration and see if, people want to contribute to more ideas. But by next week, we should finalize on 3 ideas and start working on it. I think that's my suggestion.
Some of the people have not participated. I don't know. Manya is not there. Tripti is not there. Gayatri, they have not come because of some reason, or they're going to come. They're going to join. Yeah, I feel some people are missing. Okay.
Manya, I don't know, Guruji. I think Sunday, so she's having some classes. Tripti couldn't complete her presentation. So she said she wants to come back with the presentation.
Okay. Fine. We need 1 or 2 more sessions to finalize which idea to work on.
Correct.
So we'll have to say in medical field, one idea. In physical fitness and in each of the category, maybe one idea we have to think of.
Yeah. So we can shortlist some 3-4 ideas and work on that, Guruji.
Yeah. So you can give the assignment for next week, then we can discuss.
Yes, Guruji. Yes, what we are saying, Vishnu?
Dhavalji, I have another idea for accessibility. Can I also present it in the next week?
Yeah, you can present.
Okay, Dhavalji. Thank you.
Yeah, so next week, we can have a session same time. People can present, IELTS can present their ideas, refine on their ideas and present if they want. And whoever has not been there today, they can present their ideas. So we'll have a better idea of the state of this thing. and we'll shortlist them post that.
Okay.
Okay, let us...
yeah, those who have got a feedback this time can refine your ideas based on the feedback and come back again. Right?
I didn't get you, Guruji.
No, we have given some feedbacks to different people. They can refine their presentation with the feedback and come back, I'm saying.
Yes, Guruji.
Is it clear to everybody?
Yes, Guruji.
And one more suggestion on the health category, because, you know, usually when we say, for example, target a very common disease, which is global, like say Alzheimer's and Parkinson's, etc., it becomes a challenge to come up with a unique solution or, you know, justify it as a very unique idea, versus if we can see something that is very specific to India, that would immediately bring some uniqueness to that idea. So if someone can think along those lines, if they want to work on health, that would be also a good theme, like say polio or something like that.
And also, actually, when you are working on the ideas, where you have exposure, where you know the problems, it is better to work on that.
Yeah.
And also some domain knowledge is required. For example, I have to work on Parkinson. I need to have domain knowledge from the doctor. Some doctor's advice is required. Others, on my own, these are very, very specialized fields. We need somebody to look, somebody to give us some suggestion or feedback. So you have to look for that type of expertise also. So there are two parts to this challenge, okay? One is technical part, which is artificial intelligence, and other is a domain knowledge or expertise. So we should always look for somebody with some domain knowledge or expertise. For example, today, Sahithi presented an idea. Okay, Sahithi presented a physical fitness trainer. It's a good idea, but I suggested her, she take up the dance as a dance trainer because she has a domain knowledge of dance itself. So domain knowledge, we have to combine with the technology. So that's why we have to be careful about domain knowledge also. Involve somebody whom you know, who can help you into domain knowledge also. Are we clear? Is it clear to everybody?
Yes, Prabhuji.
Right. It is always we can imagine something I know. Or Google and find out I can know, but there's not sufficient. These are all too deep and technical expert subjects for which we should at least have some friend or relative who can help us in some of these areas where you have doubt. Right? From technical side, Dawal can help from artificial intelligence side. But domain knowledge wise, you need somebody's help who can help you and guide. For example, Parkinson's disease or let us say take diabetes also. Some amount of guidance from a doctor will help. Okay. Shall we conclude? Shall we close?
Yes, Guruji.
Yes, Guruji.
Close with the prayer. Asato ma.
Asato ma.
Sadgamaya.
Sadgamaya.
Tamaso ma.
Tamaso ma.
Jyotirgamaya.
Jyotirgamaya.
Mrityorma.
Mrityorma.
Amrutam gamaya.
Amrutam gamaya.
Om shanti shanti shantihi.
Om shanti shanti shantihi.
Lokaha samastaha.
Lokaha samastaha.
Sukhino bhavantu.
Sukhino bhavantu.
Lokaha samastaha.
Lokaha samastah.
Sukhino bhavantu.
Sukhino bhavantu.
Lokaha samastah.
Lokaha samastah.
Sukhino bhavantu.
Sukhino bhavantu.
Harihi Om.
Harihi Om.
Shri Gurubhyo Namaha.
Shri Gurubhyo Namaha.
Harihi Om.
Harihi Om.
Okay. Bye, everybody.
Thank you, Prabhuji. Hari Om.
Thank you, Guruji.
Thank you,
Guruji. Hariyam, everyone.
Thank you,
Guruji.